Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 25th chapter. Jesus said to the disciples, "For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who received 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who received 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid the master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who received 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' And the one with 2 talents also came forward, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' Then the one who received 1 talent came forward, saying, 'Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours.' But his master replied, 'You wicked and lazy slave. You knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.'" The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. So I know what you're thinking. He's probably going to preach on something other than the gospel, because as the old song says, "Fools rush in where wise men never go." Well, I don't claim to be wise, so like a fool, I'm going to rush in to today's gospel. Most of you couldn't name most of the British prime ministers, but everyone has heard of Sir Winston Churchill. Winston Churchill, amongst many wonderful gifts, had the ability to fire off witty riposte in reply to verbal attacks. So one day in the House of Commons, someone noticed that he was drunk. And they said, "Sir Winston, you're drunk." He says, "Yes, and I shall be sober in the morning, but you will still be annoying." On another occasion, an opposition member of Parliament said to him, "Winston, if you were my husband, I'd prepare you a potion of poison." To which he replied, "Madam, if you were my wife, I would drink it." When Clement Attlee was elected Prime Minister right after World War II, and Winston, who had won the war, was unceremoniously dismissed as Prime Minister in the election, people were saying to him, "Well, you've got to give Mr. Attlee his due. He's a wonderful man." Said Winston. "Yes, Prime Minister, he is a very modest man." To which Sir Winston replied, "Well, yes, he has a lot to be modest about." A modest man with a lot to be modest about kind of sums up the chap who received 1 talent in the gospel reading today. This incredibly familiar parable. But what does it say about familiarity breeding contempt? I have heard this parable twisted in all sorts of verbal directions. Most often by bankers saying, "Yes, you see, you should invest your money. by folks who will look after your capital, saying, I will return to you 100-fold. Of course, it has absolutely nothing to do with money, but that doesn't stop us pretending that it does. So what does the parable say? And bear in mind, the very definition of a parable is that it's prone to misunderstanding and has depths of meaning that will never ever completely plumb. Okay, so this is a man going on a journey, and we know that the man is Jesus, and we know that the journey is his death, resurrection, and ascension. Some of his slaves, and we know by slaves that Jesus means his disciples, those who follow him, those who learn from him, ultimately those who will be nicknamed by their enemies. In the town of Antioch, they've been nicknamed by their enemies Christians. And that nickname, that insult, will become our name, Christians. So, gives to his slaves, his followers, his disciples, the Christians, and entrusts property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1. A talent is an immense amount of money. I mean, no one knows quite for sure, but the scholar's best bet is that 1 talent was 15 years' wages for a regular laborer. So this is an immense amount of money. It's as if he said, gave to them like $1 million, $50 million. It's an impressive amount of money. And talent was the name, the anglicized name, of the monetary amount. In the 15th century, this parable was so popular that eventually the name for the money, a talent, became our English word for talents, for the gifts that we receive. The English word talent comes directly from this parable in the 15th century, beginning in the 15th century. The point is, an immense amount was given, but notice an often overlooked phrase, to each according to his ability. The person who received the lot didn't receive too much. The Lord, the Master, Jesus, God gave to that man what was known to be deliverable, usable. So if you say, well, maybe this guy that got the 1 talent, maybe he was just doomed to failure. No, he got what God knew his capabilities were able to handle. Each of the 3 did, according to his ability. Then he, Jesus, went away. Ultimately, the ascension. And it takes a while for him to come back. After a long time, the master of those slaves came. Matthew's community expected Jesus to return quickly, and he didn't. And they lived in that heightened state of anticipation that Jesus would come back again. It was a sort of eschatological waiting. Anxiously waiting for the culmination of all things, waiting for Christ to come again, his parousia. And as weeks became months, and months became years, and years became decades, the community yearned and yearned for the Master, for Jesus to return. That's Matthew's context. The person who was given a lot of money used it. 2 of them did, and 1 didn't. But bear in mind, we're not talking about money here. And if it's not money, because God doesn't give us money, maybe it's more akin to the modern understanding of talents, but not talents as in the ability to whistle a tune, play the organ, or at a round ball with a round bat, which is something so crazy only Americans can do it. That was a joke, by the way. The Brits have a similar game, but we use a flat bat because we're not crazy. So what is it if it's not money and it's not just the ability to whistle or carry a tune? The New Testament is full of descriptions of spiritual gifts that God gives through the power of the Holy Spirit to those who bear his name and carry his cross. So when we hear of money being given, what is being given are gifts of the Spirit. What we hear about being used are people of faith using those gifts. When we hear of a man burying something in the ground, what he is burying is not money, but the gifts that God has given to him for the sake of the gospel and the kingdom. Now do you see the waste? Two of the people in this story take those God-given gifts and they take risks with it. They dare to dream and to imagine. They think out of the box. They leave their comfort zones. I don't care what euphemism you use or what buzz phrase you use. They get out and they get down and they get dirty and they use what they have been given. Because they know it's not given to and for them alone. They know that it's given to them to be used for the sake of the Master, for the purposes of the Master, to serve all those who follow the Master and those who have not yet come to know the Master. And so they risk everything. They risk the fortune, they risk the reputation, they risk everything so that what they have been given will be used for the kingdom. So they dare to go to dark places and bear God's light. They dare to go into places of suffering and of death and of mourning and speak of joy and light and life. They dare to go where no one else would ever dream of going, so that the gospel might be proclaimed and shared and lived. And it produces, through the power of the Holy Spirit, more than they had to begin with and more than they could ever imagine. But look at the one who is given gifts that he is capable of using. He is not in over his head. He buries it in a hole in the ground and covers it up. A powerful image of something that elsewhere in the Gospels is referred to as hiding a light under a bushel. Why does he do that? He tells you why. Listen to him. I was afraid. Fear is the most debilitating thing in all of creation. It is at the root of everything that is negative and life-draining, joy-sucking in life. Something else may present itself as a symptom, but the disease is always fear. Hate, for example. We think hate is a thing. It's not, it's a symptom of fear. You show me someone who hates someone else, and I'll show you someone who is afraid of something. Afraid of change, or afraid of the color of the other person, or afraid of the beliefs of the other person. Who feels threatened by the other person, and the fear leads to hate, and rejection, and violence, and death. You show me someone who is miserly with their time, and with their love, and with their forgiveness, as well as with their money, and I'll show you someone who is afraid. Someone who is afraid of running out. Someone who is afraid of being hurt. Someone who is afraid of loss. Scratch the surface of anything that leads to death, and right beneath the surface, gossamer-like surface, you find fear. It's at the root of everything. He was so afraid that he hid it in the ground. And the folks who heard this parable would have understood what that means. I mean, look at the amount of treasure we dig up in the middle of a field. And it's probably always been a field. Someone one day was afraid of someone stealing their gold coins and they buried them in the ground. There they lie to this day. the first banking system. Faithfulness leads to risk-taking. Fear leads to inaction. Faithfulness leads to imagination and courage. Fear leads to status quo, monotony, and playing it safe. One leads to enlargement, another to diminution. Put it another way. Remember when they're on the lake and Jesus walks on water and Peter says, "How do I get me some of this water walking stuff?" Faith allows Peter to walk on the water. But, in the words of a well-known book, if you want to walk on the water, first of all, you've got to get out of the boat. Faith and courage led Peter to swing his hairy little legs off the side of the boat and step onto the water in the first place, where his faith carried him safely into the arms of his Lord. The rest of the disciples were too afraid, and they stayed in the boat. The ending of the gospel is somewhat confusing and somewhat scary, but let me suggest to you, look at life. Those who do not give anything always seem to have nothing, do they not? Those who never share, never dream, never risk, are the ones who quintessentially have nothing. They bring nothing to the table, they share nothing, they enjoy nothing, they rejoice in nothing. For those who have nothing, even that will be taken away. Those who share, those who have joy, those who rejoice, those who spread, they always seem to have an inexhaustible supply of everything. Of smiles, of laughter, of love, of companionship. All those who have more will be given, and those who have nothing will even metaphorically take that away from them. Imagine that too at this time of year in your church. In this family, in this community, that dared last week, and I can't remember, Lois, if it was both services or just one, that sang "Through the Night of Doubt and Sorrow, Onward Goes the Pilgrim Band. Brother clasps the hand of brother, marching into the night, marching into God's future. You march when you have courage, you sing when you have joy. And with courage and faith and joy and trust and abundance and using all the gifts that God has given us, that's when we march into the future. If we have no courage and no faith and no joy, we're bounced around like a ball in a pinball machine, constantly surprised and bemused and upset by what life is doing to us. Meanwhile, those of faith and courage and imagination, those risk-takers, march into the future ready for anything that the devil will throw at them, because they march with their sisters and brothers, clasping hands and trusting in the God to whose tune they march and into whose future they march. And it is a future of abundance, of sharing, of grace, of life, of light. Do not hide your light under a bushel, but march with us. God awaits, and your sisters and brothers are with you.